This is another in the series of interviews for the Governor's Center project at the Eagleton Institute of Politics. It is February 7, 2006, and we're continuing with interviews related to key people in the Byrne administration. I'm Don Linky, and the interviewee today is Louis Gambaccini, who served as Commissioner of Transportation for Governor Byrne and also served in various key roles in transit, both in New York and Pennsylvania and on national bodies. Lou, before we get into the details of your long, varied, and extremely prominent career in transportation, I thought I'd like to start with some broader thoughts about what you feel your greatest achievements were, particularly in the Byrne administration, but also in your other roles in this region and in national transportation policy. And also deal a little bit with some of the disappointments. What are the things that you still think remain to be done in terms of transportation planning?
Well, I had the occasion recently to speak to a senior citizens group in Philadelphia. They wanted me to cover the highlights of my 50 years in public service, and I hadn't thought about it before then, but I started my comment by saying I can sum it up in two words, joy and sadness, that it was a joyful career in terms of the sense of accomplishment, the great people I worked with who were either superiors, peers, or subordinates, the sense of mission, the teamwork, the commitment. It was very exhilarating in that respect, but very depressing and sad that 50 years later, after the beginning of my career, the lack of political will and support for public transportation has been steadily diminishing at a time when it should have been steadily increasing, given all the other problems, including energy dependency on Near Eastern oil and so forth. Looking back on my career, I have to be very honest, the highlight of my career was the 3.5 years I spent in Governor Byrne's cabinet. We accomplished an incredible amount in a very short period of time. A small team of great people who really had a sense of mission. And that isn't to diminish my strong feeling, positive feelings about 30 years at the Port Authority, which was a great institution. Austin Tobin, in my opinion, was the most charismatic leader I ever had the opportunity to work with. And I've had a number of really first-class leaders to work with, including Brendan Byrne and the chairman of SEPTA when I was there. Clayton Underkoffler, former U.S. attorney. It's interesting that all three that I'm citing are attorneys, and two of the three were in U.S. attorneys' positions of one sort or another. I have thoroughly enjoyed all of my positions. The Port Authority really honed my, if I have any professional skills, they were really brought, developed there. Its commitment to professionalism, encouragement to being active in public affairs and professional societies, and to take leadership in the fields of transportation in which we were engaged. When I left the Army 52 years ago, I remember articulating to my wife that I wanted to go with an organization that I could feel comfort with and pride in the associations of staff at all levels, especially my superiors, and that was the beginning of a great great run. I think looking back, I've been fortunate to operate in that kind of professional environment in every one of my positions, despite the fact they were all generally in the political sphere, but somewhat insulated from some of the crass compromises that often are required in the political sphere.
Lou, you mentioned a couple of personal things. Let's go back a little bit and talk about your sort of family, early upbringing, education, and also, I think most significantly, what sort of provoked your interest in public service and transportation specifically?
Good question. My parents both immigrated from Italy, my mother when she was 6 and my father when he was 21. They met in this country. I was one of two children, the younger of the two. I have an older sister. my first memories were at 8 years old going to Washington on a tourist kind of trip with my parents, and mesmerized by government and the institution, and adored FDR and what he was trying to do in the Depression. I was a very mature young person. I was fascinated by government, even at that tender age, and that never diminished. Went to college, my mother insisting that I take accounting, and I never took an accounting course, but decided there's no way I wanted to be an accountant, so I switched to political science, and with an emphasis in international relations, I thought I'd like to go into the Foreign Service, which idea was disabused when I spent time in Korea close to the Syngman Rhee government near the end of the war, and disgusted by the corruption of that government and the brutality of it, decided I didn't want to spend a career in Foreign Service working with dictatorships of that sort, and then decided I wanted to go into city management. So I went to this Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs on the GI Bill, and with an assistantship that was granted by the school after I left the Army in 1955, and was almost about to take a position at the federal government at the Bureau of the Budget, that's the predecessor to the Office of Management and Budget, when the Port Authority persuaded me that life there would be very exciting, and made that commitment. And that.
Who was your initial contact at the Port Authority? Did you have a mentor?
Initially, it was a recruitment by the head of the recruiting division, Felix Lopez, and he brought me down for a grand tour. In part, I was seduced as somebody with absolutely no background and being picked up at the airport by helicopter and having a tour of all the facilities by helicopter. It was pretty grand stuff. And but the more I learned about the intrinsic nature of the institution, high commitment to public service and public activity, the necessity to be self-sustaining, which inculcated an entrepreneurial spirit, so it seemed to me the best of both private and public sectors, commitment to professionalism, commitment to really supporting the staff but demanding performance and loyalty and the like. And I never regretted the decision. It was just a great choice. And after I got there, I found there was one other person who happened to be the number two person, who also had gone to the Maxwell School. And that was Matt Lukens, terrific guy. He was the number two to Austin Tobin.
And did you develop sort of a strong personal relationship, given your sort of common alumni status at the Maxwell School?
Yes, but removed and deferential. I mean, he was many rungs above me when I first started. But it warmed up. As I moved up the ladder, we get to be closer and closer friends, you know.
And what were your early positions and responsibilities at the Port Authority?
I started as a management. Well, first of all, I was recruited to be a management trainee, which means you get into a 6 month to a year training program with rotational assignments and lots of classroom activity. And this was interesting because I really couldn't afford to do it. By that time I had two children and the pay was $4,000 a year, and I had been making $5,000 as a Army second lieutenant. And there was enough rigidity so they couldn't do anything about it. So the deal was I would drop out of the trainee program and get assigned to a particular job that was closer to the $5,000. But as a result of this, they changed the basis on which they recruited and gave additional financial credits for new hires who had military service and who had graduate degrees. So had that been in place, I would have stayed in the trainee program. So my first assignment was working for a really marvelous human being called a fellow by the name of Harvey Sherman, who had spent a number of years in Washington working for the USIA and for Jim Webb, who was a legendary figure in Washington, a great manager. And that was a sure delight. I always felt when I worked for Harvey that he was far more, giving me more credit for ability than I had. And so he was always pushing me to higher and higher kinds of commitments and performance. I was assigned to a major two-year study of the reorganization of the whole engineering function of the Port Authority, and that was one of the major activities of the Port Authority. And it was a great education and a great experience, and it resulted in a lot of changed structure and changed philosophy. So that sort of gave me some status as a participant in a major reform effort in the Port Authority. Then I was asked to work as executive assistant to the executive director for a year. This was a rotational job. And I remember, I literally took a demotion to take it, but I was urged to do so by Harvey Sherman on the basis that it would expose me to the board and to senior staff and the processes. And I remember his caution was, you'll either ruin your career or enhance it greatly, but it's an exciting thing and a rare opportunity. You ought to do it. So I did it.
And about what year was this?
1960.
1960.
And in that year, we unveiled plans for the World Trade Center. We were cited for contempt of Congress, our chairman and executive director, who, because of Manny Sellers' chairmanship of the Judiciary Committee and his anger at the Port Authority for not conveying contracts to him when he was in Congress, started a fishing expedition to find internal problems, and up to a point there was great cooperation. At a point, the chairman and executive director decided this was totally unwarranted and totally without any clear objectives and refused to continue to cooperate. So that went to the Supreme Court. Tom Dewey was our attorney, and the Supreme Court invalidated found that there was no basis of a contempt of Congress citation.
Let's take a short break.
Yeah.
They want me for something. Lou, before we proceed with your continuing career with the Port Authority, discuss a little bit about the sort of role of the Port Authority and some of the controversies that it was involved in. You just spoke about one controversy that involved the Congress and sort of disputes about the legal powers and responsibilities of the authority. But discuss, the sort of concept of the authority from an insider's perspective, and then we'll talk later about your changing hats as you got out of the Port Authority and dealt with the authority more on an arm's length basis.
Well, the Port Authority of New York, New Jersey, at the time the Port of New York Authority, founded in 1921, was the prototype independent authority in the United States. It was fashioned after the London Port Authority, and it was designed to straddle two political jurisdictions, New York and New Jersey, and to be based on relative independence from political process, self-sustaining financially, but politically responsive to the extent that the two governors would appoint the board and then have veto power over the actions of the Port Authority. It was founded based on a compact of the federal government that would permit this kind of regional entity to transpire. For the first several years, it had difficulty getting legs, and its first major project was a comprehensive plan for transportation, mostly railroads, in the region, which was roundly denounced by the railroads, and some of the railroad leaders said, if they had any idea that we were going to muck around into their territory, they wouldn't have permitted the founding of the Port Authority. So that never went anywhere. the first momentum got started when the two states conveyed to the Port Authority the then newly finished Holland Tunnel, which became a funding base to launch other projects, and in short order, Staten Island Bridges, George Washington Bridge were also built, and this became a funding mechanism that, like a revolving fund, was able to authorize other projects. So from then on, it was constructing a lot of major activities, which later evolved into multi-transportation activities like the airports and marine facilities and that sort of thing. On balance, I think it's been a brilliant construct. I had internal differences at times that we were not being sensitive enough and attuned to political realities, and we're, you know, there were some tendencies towards such independence and arrogance that I thought, you know, the time would take its toll if we continued such policies, especially with regard to total rejection of any role in public transportation. The pressures kept building and building. I remember the day I took the job first in, I guess it was June of 1956. I think literally those that very day, there was a call for the Port Authority to take over all of the New York City subway, which was utterly impossible. There was just not enough funding capacity to take on that kind of loss leader. But neither was there any effort to show enough responsiveness to be helpful in the planning or the like until much later, until the pressure became unbearable. And having said that, the quality of the staff, the high standards, the absolute rejection of political interference in the award of contracts or appointment powers to staff appointments made it a climate of, you know, high merit. It was a meritocracy with almost consuming interest in raising standards and productivity and management expertise. So I'd say on balance, it was an extremely successful, worthy kind of evolution. Since then, there have been thousands of other authorities created. Many of them were ludicrous in their lack of genuine purpose or the like. Some of the others became quite effective. In fact, it became the primary form of administration for regional public transportation systems across the country.
Was the reluctance of the Port Authority board, and I assume the staff, to assume a more expansive role in public transit solely based on sort of the fiscal realities that this would be a very expensive proposition?
Yes, and that it we had a requirement to our bondholders that we had to have a conservative approach. We had what we called, now I forgot the lingo, but it was a coverage ratio. We had to have at least 1.3 times the revenue to cover the costs. That would give us a cushion and protect bondholders and assure conservative effectiveness. And it was very clear when the first major pressure built that public transportation not only could not even break even, but was an increasing deficit almost without limit. And that certainly was absolutely valid. So for an organization that was pledged to a 1.3 cover, had to be self-sustaining, this was almost certain disaster for the organization. I have no quarrel with that logic, but I do have quarrel at the time with not trying to show some responsiveness within the capacities of the organization that would not affect or undermine the fiscal stability and yet show some willingness to be helpful.
Mm-hmm. And going back again to your sort of early years with the Port Authority in the late 50s, early 60s, did the two states sort of have a cohesive position at that time, or were New York and New Jersey at loggerheads as to what the Port Authority's mission and agenda should
the
be?
The primary pressure came from New York and trying to be provide relief to the subway system. Later, before Governor Byrne was elected, his predecessor, Governor Cahill, picked up the cudgels on transit. Before Cahill, the condition of the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad, which was considered a vital link between the states, now called PATH, was building pressure in New Jersey to find some solution to a bankrupt status and a terribly deteriorating facility that was critically important to commutation from New Jersey. And at a point when there was an impasse between the states on building the World Trade Center, the political deal was suggested that would link the Port Authority's acquisition of PATH to the World Trade Center. Became a joint project that both states bought into. Now that became the first public transportation operational commitment by the port. A condition of that was something called the statutory fence, that if the deficits exceeded 10% of the then existing reserve fund, that we would not be permitted by law, by contract, to exceed or to be drawn into any more further public transportation commitment. To the Port Authority's credit, when it made that deal, they did not shrink from doing a first-class job of upgrading PATH, whatever the costs. Now, obviously, once you were past the 10%, then that blocked any further risk. On the other hand, that didn't mean that once we passed it, they would try to, you know, cut costs and do the minimal. They were, in effect, they were saying whatever it takes to do the right job. The 10% did not limit the deficit on PATH, but it did prevent further involvement. So I think, you know, to their credit, I didn't mean to be overly harsh in talking about the political tone deafness on transit, but once they were into it, they were into it with a lot of class.
Let's go back and rejoin your personal story, say around 1960 or so, and talk a little bit about the evolution of your Port Authority career from that point on.
Well, when I finished my year up in the front office, it was everything that I had been told it would be in terms of a fascinating experience and a career-enhancing experience. I then went back to a promoted job in management and organization and management division, but I was bored out of my tree. And after about a year, I was thinking maybe I ought to leave the Port Authority and start anew. But almost at the point when I was really getting bored, I was invited to become the number two person in a new office that was created to plan for the acquisition of the Hudson Manhattan Railroad. And I was quite surprised because it meant a huge promotion. I think probably unprecedented number of grades that I went up. And I then managed the acquisition, the transition from the old to the new, and planned that over the course of 6 months to a year. Then it became a full-fledged department, and I was the number two member of the department. And it was really a learning experience, a total immersion, had no real background in the subject. But I really got caught up with it and thoroughly enjoyed it. Shortly after we took over, we were embroiled in labor negotiations that were getting out of control because the unions, of which there were about 18, wanted instant equality with the rest of the Port Authority, and having been bankrupt for so many years with a big gap in wages and in benefits. And we were prepared to do it, but not have to then live with the obsolete, very constrictive labor management practices that had preceded. In the prior bankrupt period, in lieu of wages and benefits, the union got ever-increasing controls over how the place would be managed. Mm-hmm. So our deal was you get the benefits and pay, but only in return for a lot more flexibility. It took about a year or two of full-time negotiating on my part to get through that crisis, but it went very well, and we developed a good relationship with labor and demonstrated that we weren't out to take it out of their flesh, but to improve the whole, you know, safety, the climate, the respect for their claims, and it developed very well.
Let's backtrack a little bit. When you received your promotion to this, you know, significant position, presumably over the heads of a lot of people who were higher on the ladder in terms of your position at the time, was there a particular person, again, who was sort of responsible for selecting you rather than the other candidates for the job?
I don't think so. I think it was a combination of Austin Tobin, Matt Lukens, the director of administration, who was also my boss, Dan Kershant, and Harvey Sherman in consultation. And it was usually some combination or all four of them who made the key appointments of all sorts in the organization. I thought that they were being reckless because I didn't think I was anywhere near ready for it.
Did you encounter any resentment from people who were more senior to you in taking over their responsibilities?
Ironically, the most resentment came from a couple of people who were very, very junior and had no reason to aspire, and less so from people higher in rank who accepted it very, very readily.
Okay. Well, let's continue, I guess, in terms of the acquisition and sort of the integration of the rail lines into the Port Authority.
Right. Well, key to it was, and I think this is key to any kind of merger or acquisition, was an assessment of who got carried into the new organization that we're worth working with and who should be finessed to find other employment or retirement. And that took 6 months to a year, I'd say, to really develop a level of comfort in knowing what we were getting and how to work with it. And I think that went generally well. We didn't go in with a major meat cleaver. There were several people in key positions that clearly were not up to the role, in our opinion. And one, on a case-by-case basis, finessed, a graceful parting of the ways, and then in a couple of other cases, recruited from outside. Mm-hmm. I remember in one case, make a bad judgment on outside selection and deciding in short order the person was a bad choice and we needed to finesse him out as well. But mostly we added some strength in key places and had to attack a lot of problems at the same time. There had been no effective management training for years and years. Maintenance was a total disaster, and so we went through a period of, in fact, this is cited in one of the articles I just uncovered about how to deal with the human resources emphasis on training, on communications, and rebuilding the organization. The point I was going to make is having to live for several years with major continued breakdowns and find ways to get the passengers to be understanding and patient and keep them informed that we're doing everything. And we started what was unprecedented at the time was letters to the passengers, particularly after major breakdowns or incidents, explaining exactly what happened, what we were doing to prevent it from recurring, and a pledge to continue to try to improve and assure a higher level of reliability and stability. And it worked. I mean, we got incredible patience for the kinds of delays and difficulties that we still experienced until we really got the shop in order. Key to it, obviously, it's a very complex. We had the sharpest peak hour of any system in the world. That is the relationship of the number of people in the peak 1 hour compared to the other 23 hours a day. We had trains arriving on a merging basis every 90 seconds at a single control point. There was no tolerance. Everything was pushing at maximum capacity and with a decrepit physical plant. The electric power system was a mess, signals were a mess, communications. And, you know, let me tell you, I lost a lot of sleep worrying about the potential of disasters and the safety problems that might have transpired. But we limped through, and one of the biggest dramatic things that happened during that period was the power failure of 64 or 65, October 9th, I think it was, when all of the region went black. That meant we suddenly had people stuck in tunnels for hours. The tunnels were in horrible shape with greasy ties and rails. There was no lighting and no communications. So we had to just immediately get all of our operating people out into the tunnels with flashlights. I was out there. Things started about 6 p.m. on, I think it was October 9th, and we didn't have the last passengers out of the tunnel until about 5 or 6 in the morning. But we had to get people literally to find the trains, guide them very carefully, because it was such unsafe condition, with flashlights to exits and the like. So that was at a time when we were ill-prepared for that kind of emergency, but it came off well. I mean, nobody was injured or worse, but it was a tough period.
Perhaps this is a good point to talk a little bit more broadly about the condition of railroads in the region and nationally at that time, because I guess now in the early 60s is maybe the depth of the sort of decline of, of the railroads in the country.
Well, again, because of the Port Authority's urging, I became active at the end of the 60s, 68. I was asked by Bill Ronan, who had just become head of the Institute for Rapid Transit in Washington, unpaid job. This was a board job, and he asked me to be the chairman of the legislative committee. So I started active lobbying and got some real quick education on the condition of transit around the country. And the similar trends were happening everywhere. Private sector could not make a profit. And conditions of physical deterioration, service deterioration, declining ridership, and deficits was building all across the country. So starting in 68, we started a significant lobbying effort, which succeeded 2 years later in getting a tenfold increase in authorization on funding federal support to transit. At that time, it went from $100 million a year to $1 billion a year, spaced over the following couple of years. But it started to raise the visibility of the issue, and it was the beginning of a steady takeover by public entities of private operations. Washington Metro was conveyed to an authority that would manage it, Washington Metro, and that happened elsewhere around the country. And so there was an active lobbying effort which continued to build support, both federal and state, around the country. And as I say, the conditions were similar around the country, not only rail, but bus. Los Angeles completely eliminated its bus system its rail system. The bus systems, however, were also deteriorating badly, and there was a gradual improvement through the 70s and 80s, but not to the point where adequate funding really assured top quality service and physical conditions. Many of the systems, like SEPTA, which I managed for 8.5 years, is still suffering from some terrible physical conditions that they haven't had the funding to correct.
Mm-hmm. But the PATH system, as it evolved in the 60s, became sort of a national model, I think, how to sort of rehabilitate an aging railroad into a modern public transit system. Do you want to sort of discuss a little bit more as you proceeded with that?
Yeah, I think that's a fair statement. We were the first system to be fully air conditioned across the country. Now it's become the norm all through the country. And I think a lot of the things we did were innovative and copied elsewhere. We were fortunate that we had a rich uncle that was not stinting and giving us what we needed. Now, most other systems, including SEPTA, which I managed, never had that happy circumstance. But again, I can't stress enough the importance of the board's commitment to doing it right. Once, if we took on the responsibility and had the financial capacity, we were going to do it right.
And who do you...
I don't think the camera's shooting it. Lou, now with the PATH system, you have increasing responsibility dealing not only within the Port Authority and its staff and the board, but also on the outside with political players in New York and New Jersey. Could you talk a little bit about that experience and the differences or similarities, if any, between the two states?
Well, my relationship was quite different in each of the two states. PATH is truly 90% a New Jersey presence, not only physically, but the bulk of the passengers come from New Jersey, and is a very high value item for the state of New Jersey because of its because it carries so many commuters in the peak period to New York. New York exaggerated its disinterest in PATH in order to have political debating points with New Jersey, saying, well, this deficit is for the benefit of New Jersey, not for us, which is to minimize the real importance to New York of having that volume of commuters coming from out of state and accessing particularly lower Manhattan.
And that's sort of typical of the way the two states jockey in terms of negotiating what the Port Authority should be doing, isn't it?
Exactly so. And I am convinced, despite all of the fights between the two states about who's getting more out of the Port Authority, that in fact the Port Authority has been very even-handed about trying to level the commitment to both states financially and in worthy projects. But it has been argued both ways by both states. But anyway, my primary interaction has been in New Jersey with communities, counties, and particularly with state. It started when I started in the PATH, that was in 62, and then I became the general manager and director in 66 in the Hughes administration, and I was developed close friendship and relationship with the late David Goldberg, who was a terrific guy. Then later, John Cole became the first head of the department, what was then, for the first time, Department of Transportation. It had been the Highway Department before in the Cahill administration. Cahill became almost fanatic in his determination to force the Port Authority to get much more heavily involved in public transportation. And he and Austin Tobin really had a very testy relationship. I sometimes thought that, you know, it was the curse of the Irish. They could not find a way to make peace and work together because I think they both had positive intentions. That deteriorated. In fact, I'd say led directly to Austin Tobin's decision to retire after 30 years and fairly abruptly because Cahill had placed some people on the board that were making life very difficult for Austin to continue as executive director. And I worked well with David Goldberg and with Hughes. I didn't have that much contact with Cahill, but I thought he had good intentions, but unfortunately, it just seemed like they unduly provoked each other at various times, and it was a decline in relationship. Then,
before we go too much further, expand a little bit on the role of David Goldberg, who was also a key figure in New Jersey transportation history and had, like yourself, varied roles in New Jersey government, both inside government and outside as an advisor for many, many years.
I guess David technically was the first head of the DOT. I think DOT was established in 67 or so. David was a bright lawyer, politically savvy, and I thought was a very fine professional, great state official, and played a key role. I think he was one of the architects of the merger of the World Trade Center PATH projects to have both a part of a single package that both states could actively support. I had numerous meetings with David. I thought very highly of him. I remember at one point I offered to turn over PATH to the state, lock, stock, and barrel for $1, and his immediate reaction was, beware of Greeks bearing gifts. But we had a good relationship, and he was, I think, a creative thinker, and hence the role he played in, I think, fashioning the joint legislation, and a good start to the broadening of the highway department into a bona fide Department of Transportation. I think the subsidy program started with him and then took off after he left office and went down an unfortunate path of escalating costs, deteriorating service, and that's when we had to confront it in the Byrne administration.
And as we get sort of further into the latter part of the 60s, you had your first contact with who would later then be Governor Byrne. Could you discuss that?
Yeah, he was then the chairman of the Public Utilities Commission. I think it was called PUC at that time. Maybe it was PSC, I forgot. Anyway, PATH had an accident that he insisted on investigating on behalf of the Public Utilities Commission. And again, two Irishmen going at it. He insisted that the PUC had jurisdiction, and Austin Tobin, who also was a lawyer, said no way. There was no jurisdiction, and he categorically opposed any such intrusion. So there was a nose-to-nose conflict there for a while until finally cooler heads prevailed, and I think they both agreed it made sense to proceed with the investigation conditioned on the PUC acknowledging it's without prejudice to the position of the Port Authority that they didn't have jurisdiction, but it would be the Port Authority's willingness to cooperate that would let the investigation proceed. So he undertook personally, Brendan Byrne, the investigation, a series of hearings in Newark at the State Office Building on Raymond Boulevard. And it was at the time, I remember vividly, because at the time of the assassinations of Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy, they happened while the hearings were going on. So that would have been 68, spring of 68. And the hearings went very well. And I guess Brendan Byrne and I, we didn't become friends, but I think we developed a good relationship of mutual respect. Then later he was elected governor, and I developed a very good relationship with Alan Sagner, his commissioner of transportation, and the senior staff, some of whom became very close friends, like Martin Robbins and, I knew, but I didn't get to be quite so close to Manny Carballo and Peter Stengel and I have been long-standing good friends and others. So I became quite heavily involved with Sagner and his senior staff in the Department of Transportation, working on projects like a proposed extension of PATH to Plainfield with a stop at Newark Airport and several other projects. Then in the spring of 77, Alan Sagner resigned as commissioner to become chairman of the Port Authority, and for 1 year the post was held by somebody on an acting basis, Russell Mullen. And the problems were building very rapidly, particularly on the deterioration of public transportation. So Alan Sagner, I think it was his original idea that I should go to New Jersey and be the commissioner. I wanted no part of it because it was a considerable reduction in salary because I had three kids in college, three in high school, and very comfortable in my role at the Port Authority. But Alan persevered, and I said the only condition that my wife would permit me to do it is that I be protected in income and the right to return to the Port Authority. And to my amazement, I was totally convinced it couldn't be worked out, but they did work it out. But Alan had proposed my candidacy and Byrne because of our former relationship. But even more important, I think, than Byrne's and my relationship was the crisis that was building was mostly public transit, not highway. And a number of the commuter groups were pushing my nomination, as was the publisher of the Ridgewood newspaper, who was an avid rail fan. And so he pushed me, as did Judge LeBrec from the Jersey Shore. There were three commuter groups growing in violence and intensity, near violence, that's overstated, to do something about public transportation. So the combination of that lobbying, and I was not receptive to it initially, but I guess after 16 years on PATH, I decided I was getting a little stale and I could use a little bit of change of scene. So when they started to work out the potential deal that would permit me to do it and still have an opportunity to return, I decided to go along. Byrne proposed this to me at a meeting we had at Drumthwacket on St. Patrick's Day,
Morphin?
1978.
Morphin? I'm sorry. Ed Morphin.
No, it was at Drumthwacket.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We had a meeting. I was making a presentation on something we called later TransPAC. This was how to use $120 million Port Authority money to leverage federal funding. So we came up with a $3 billion proposal that was a major lift to public transportation. And after the meeting, he asked me to meet with him in another room and made the offer of the position. And I had already had advance warning from Alan that would be coming. So I was prepared by setting three conditions that I would have to be satisfied on if I were to do it. One was I would not be required to be involved politically because I wouldn't have the time. There's so much that had to be done and I had to give it my full attention. Two, that he not press me to take political appointments in the department. I needed every non-civil service job to get some of the best people to help me make things happen. And thirdly, that as required, he'd support me on some of the legislative efforts that we'd be about. And he lived up to all three, and it was just a great run. It was a good relationship. And we accomplished a lot. There were several people already in the department, Martin Robbins, Amy Rosen. George Warrington was a very junior guy that we elevated rapidly. And then I supplemented that with several outside recruitments and came a great team of high purpose and great energy. And I kept telling them they were too young and inexperienced to know that what they were accomplishing simply couldn't be done.
Again, in deciding whether to accept the offer from Governor Byrne to become Commissioner of the Department of Transportation, were there people outside your own family that you sort of went to for advice on this sort of radical career shift?
Yes, definitely, particularly at the Port Authority, a couple of people that I trusted. One was the counsel who specialized in New Jersey affairs, Welch, I forgot his first name, and he was very encouraging, thought it would be a good move and that it would, good opportunity to do some things. And so he was very positive. Of course, Alan Sagner was very strongly supportive. And then I was being pushed by, again, Judge LeBrec and Bennett Fischler from Ridgewood News and some others to do it.
Did you try to contact sort of people in Trenton as to what Governor Byrne was like to work for, other than Alan Sagner?
I'm sure that I asked people like Peter Stengel and Martin Robbins, with whom I had worked closely, and the feedback was positive. And I have nothing but the highest regard for working for Governor Byrne. He was a visionary, he had guts, very supportive when needed, and otherwise gave us wide berth to do a lot of things on our own.
Now that you're commissioner at the department, what did you see the first things to get done?
Well, one of the things that we did, that I did, that was, I guess, better than I realized, was we had so much on our plate that I set up several simultaneous task forces to deal with different things. One, public transportation, and that was largely Martin Robbins. Cliff Goldman's brother was then, who had previously worked in state government, was now outside counsel. I forgot his first name.
Richard
Goldman. He, Martin, and an outside consultant by the name of Arlie Reno comprised the task group to keep pressing on public transportation. And we crafted a strategy on developing four reports. One was called The Horror Story, all the ills that were wrong with the system. Another was a survey of best practices around the country and the world and how to deal with these kind of issues. Third was, The fourth was the recommendation to set up NJ Transit. Separately, I assigned a newly appointed assistant commissioner that I hired from Ohio as our planner, the top planner for the department. Gave him the challenge of coming up with a state plan that would be supported, sponsored by all 21 counties. Now, up to this point, for 10, 15 years, we were not getting anywhere near the funding we should have gotten from Washington because of the counties checkmating each other. If we don't get ours, you don't get yours. Nobody got anything. So, you know, in effect, I brought the county planners together and said, you don't leave this room until we have a common approach to cost-benefit priority and what projects take precedence over what others. And they all bought into that. Melvin Lear was the guy, he's still local, that I brought in from Ohio. He did a great job. He was just a very smooth, interpersonal cajoler and brought this into line. And we had a good plan and everybody really lined up. And that later helped when we had to get legislative support on the bond issue, that many of the legislators were not that strong about pushing their pet projects because their planners had bought into this process of objective evaluation of cost-benefit. But that really set the stage then for TransPAC, this $3 billion program, to be rolled out, and then a successful bond issue. We had gotten a $475 million bond issue approved by a 2-to-1 vote only a couple months after we got NJ Transit through the legislature, and it was the first time in three efforts that a transportation bond issue succeeded, and the first time ever that the education bond issue failed. And the vote was by, as I say, 2-to-1 for the bond issue. So the 475 bond issue, the 120 port authority, and the leveraging of federal highway and transit money got us to a $3 billion. I remember Chris Jackman, who was Speaker of the House, was off the wall crazy, saying, billions? Are you talking billions? Are you nuts? Now, I was in Washington last week, and they're talking about gaps in the trillions in the funding for the newly authorized transportation bill. That within a couple of years, they're going to be out of money.
Now, you mentioned that you received a commitment from Governor Byrne that he would not push sort of political appointments on you as you sort of assembled your new team in the Department of Transportation. But what about the sort of contrasts in management and your freedom to sort of pick people, promote them, fire them, in terms of working at the Port Authority, which I assume you had quite a bit more freedom and flexibility in personnel decisions?
Yes.
And the state bureaucracy, where you have to deal with sort of new things like civil service and mayors who have people in the departments that they're protecting and so forth?
Very good question. There were a handful of political appointments within the department that were permitted. I think it was like 14 or 15 out of 5,500. So those were precious. I could pick people that I thought I knew to be a good caliber. A couple of them were people already there, Martin Robbins and Amy Rosen and a couple others. But the other ones that were either vacant or were soon to be vacant, in one case, I tried to get on with somebody who was there and couldn't, so I moved him aside to a position that he could do far better and was more comfortable in because he wasn't being responsive on a very key role. So I had enough capacity there to get people who would help me radiate the kinds of things that I was trying to do. To be fair, there were a number of senior civil servants that I thought were gems. They were competent, professional, and in effect said, you know, we're here to do your bidding. Tell us what priorities and projects, and we'll be your loyal lieutenants. And they were, like Friedenrich. Jack Friedenrich was superb. He was the chief engineer. However, on that point, when I created NJ Transit, Governor Byrne every now and then would ask me if I would interview somebody, but he was careful to say, it's your decision. Every now and then he would also bug me and say, just because they're political doesn't mean they're necessarily incompetent. And I'd say, I agree with you. And in one or two cases, excuse me, I did go along with a selection from that source, but he was very careful and lived up to the commitment not to push me or force me to take anybody. However, when NJ Transit was set up, I did prevail on him, and it was an uphill argument, but he finally relented to let me create the non-union staff outside of the civil service. And my argument to him was, and this is directly a result of Port Authority, there were several things I borrowed from the Port Authority. An unpaid board, heavy emphasis on caliber in that board, which has been even better than I ever dreamed. McGoldrick, 25 years service on that board, brought tremendous stability and wisdom to that board. But I argued that I could get the best people in the country to come here if I had enough latitude by literally several thousand dollars above the civil service cap. And that was exactly, he finally went along with it, and it certainly proved the difference between being locked into a rigid ceiling and for, you know, you're talking about a multi-billion dollar operation with, again, on the order, I think at the time was about 10,000 people. And it just seemed like it was a shame to cut off your nose despite your face. And I think NJ Transit, in many ways, has the same sheen of professionalism and integrity and the like that the Port Authority had.
Now, you mentioned that Alan Sagner, who was Governor Byrne's first commissioner of the department, was a sort of significant player in persuading you to accept the offer from the governor. Do you recall any other advice from Alan Sagner in, as you sort of took office in terms of what he had tried to do, what problems he had encountered?
Not really. He started, to his credit, started the effort to set up something akin to NJ Transit, but was frustrated, I think, in large part because he was viewed as politically ambitious. I think he had plans or thoughts about running for governor. And the Republicans really, I think, gave him no end of trouble. And also, somebody once told me it takes two or three tries at something as significant as that to finally succeed. So that was a necessary first or second step to get the whole problem elevated and illuminated. I do remember telling Dave Goldberg and Alan Sagner that they had to find a way to break out of the consuming quagmire of the subsidy program, that you can't keep pumping more money in for worse and worse results. And so when I got to the job, I felt I had to follow my own advice and find a structural solution. By the way, earlier I was talking about the parallel thing. So we had the NJ, the Public Transportation Task Force, one on the plan, the statewide plan with priority projects, another one on the bond issue. So these things were working in parallel, and they all came to, and were delivered literally within a year and 3 months, starting a year and 3 months and ending about a year and a half or year and 9 months later, all these things fell into place.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we proceed now to talk a little bit more specifically about the creation of New Jersey Transit,
okay,
and how that came about and what problems you encountered and how they were overcome.
Well, we fashioned the legislation and literally, deliberately made a couple of or had provisions that we knew would be changed. So, for example, the size of the board. I didn't want to go above 12, but I also felt if I, wherever I started, I was going to be inched up and increasing the size of the board. So we started at 5, and I figured we'd either be forced to settle at 7, 9, or 11 or so the like. And we settled at 7. And I think it was a good outcome because three of the board members are ex officio. One is a floater and appointed by the governor. One is the treasurer, and the other is the chairman and commissioner of transportation. That was deliberately designed so the state government could not abdicate responsibility, as do other states, like Pennsylvania, where there's no clear responsibility for the operation. And so that's worked splendidly because it meant that every governor is so vested in it that they can't really duck the responsibility. The other four are rotating 4-year terms on a staggered basis appointed by the governor. And the governor gave me complete latitude, and that's a case where in one particular case I went along with somebody he asked me to interview. And he was a good, not great, but good board member, and two of the other three were spectacular. They stayed for many, many years, and one brought great business acumen and another legal and deep dedication to transportation. I learned from the Port Authority the importance of getting top-flight board members for whom pay and perks were not a significant attraction, and that's what we replicated at NJ Transit. Outside of the civil service, high emphasis on professionalism. It was a brutal battle to get the thing approved, but things started to coalesce. My own state assemblyman, Kerry Edwards, who later became Attorney General, was a Republican. My hometown was in a Republican area, so the two assemblymen and the senator were all Republican. Well, he bought into this so completely. At a point, I said, are you sure you want to commit this early because you may want to weigh the political consequences? He said, no, I'm satisfied. However, I was the victim of a lot of the anti-government mentality that even was there back then, not nowhere near as intense now. The argument that everyone knows government can't do anything right, so why should we go from private to public? A number of the most ardent spokesmen for that point of view have told me since this was the right way to go, and they were dead wrong. But at the time it was a potent argument, and we had to keep chipping away. I think, well, the interesting thing is Brendan Byrne was governor, Democrat, and both houses were controlled by Democrats. The two committee chairmen, House and Senate, were both Democrats, the chairman, and both totally opposed to the legislation.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, you mentioned Kerry Edwards. Who were the other personalities that you recall?
Well, Frank Herbert was ardent in the Senate in pushing the bill, and he glows every time he talks about NJ Transit. He regards it as the high point in his whole career. We've talked about Alan Lowenstein. Well, that comes later on the acquisition of TNJ. Harold Hodes and Bob McKay played a great role in legislative liaison and nurturing legislators to the point of the vote. Byrne was gutsy as hell to a point that I thought he was dangerous. He set a deadline after which there would be no transportation service in the state. I said, knowing you, I know you mean you'll do it, but you're crazy. You can't do that. And so, but that was what it took to get the legislature to act. Otherwise, they would have continued to procrastinate and not ever bite the bullet. And so that really got the whole legislature focused like they wouldn't otherwise have been. Other legislators, the two chairmen who were such a problem, both from the same party. Oh, Hudson County was holding hostage the legislation to Governor Byrne's appointment of a political hack to a judgeship. And Byrne wasn't going to relent. And in this, I said, you're absolutely right. As much as I want the bill, you can't give ground on that. And he held his own, and we got it through without Hudson County. Mm-hmm. And that Byrne didn't think it was possible, but it did come off. And we got enough Republican votes to get it over the line.
And of course, the legislative style and strategy that Governor Byrne pursued, as you described it, sort of drawing this line in the sand, saying that all service would stop after a given date, was also sort of typical of other similar confrontational positions he had taken, first of all with
income
the school
tax,
finance
yeah.
and the income tax, and then later with the Pinelands.
Right.
So this is sort of another, I guess, example of that type of strategy. And as you said, you sort of were suggesting maybe more cautious, a more compromising approach.
Right.
But in retrospect, you think
he was right. He was absolutely right.
Now, in terms of the department, did you feel that there was any jealousy of staff seeing this new entity being created with salaries a lot higher, lot more freedom in perhaps the job responsibilities? In comparison with the people who remained at DOT?
No, I didn't sense that at all. There were a handful of people that were already at DOT, hired specifically to manage the subsidy program. Some of them were selfless beyond belief. Dick Anderson, who died of cancer at an early age. Ben Feigenbaum, who did a brilliant job under the worst of conditions. And there was a good relationship and a good respect both ways. I didn't sense any came to my attention, any resentment. And as I say, the professionals were better than I expected that were there in the civil service. Good soldiers, good performers. So that did not become a problem at all.
Okay. Now,
In fact, a couple of the civil service people came over to be full-time staff at NJ Transit.
And New Jersey Transit is a public authority.
Yes.
But it's not named as an authority. Do you want to discuss a little bit the sort of background for choosing the name of New Jersey Transit as a corporation as opposed to an authority?
You know, there wasn't a whole lot of focus or thought about it. Many of the other ones around the country are authorities. Some are not. They're called districts or like BART Rapid Transit District, Washington Metro, but it is clearly and purely an authority. It's not a self-sustaining authority by a long measure, but it has all the other attributes of an authority. But we didn't put a lot of time and effort. I don't remember that what tipped it toward corporation rather than authority. I draw a blank.
Okay. Now, in terms of getting New Jersey Transit organized and going, what again did you sort of see the first task, and how much did you take a direct personal role or sort of give the discretion to the people you had recruited to staff the key supervisory positions?
Mostly discretion. We brought in Jerry Primo, who had worked in the U.S. Department of Transportation and in other positions, and he was a take-charge kind of guy and really got the thing launched well. But he was supported and buttressed by people who provided the transition. Martin Robbins was who was acting executive director and then became number two to Jerry. So it was, again, a good mix of some people who were already part of the groups we took over, like TNJ and the railroads, some that were recruited from outside, and a few that were transferred from Department of Transportation. That's pretty much the model at PATH and the model at NJ Transit, and I think it produces a good blend of old wisdom and experience, freshness of thinking and approach in management, and overall a good team effort.
Well, now you have created an entity. Describe, I guess, how that entity got started in terms of acquiring the assets that it would have to manage and operate.
Well, that was what happened. Was there were a lot of very small bus operators, and they were mostly quick to be willing to sell out and become part of this larger entity. It took a little longer to acquire the TNJ.
The Transport of New Jersey.
Right. That was a subsidiary of Public Service Electric and Gas, and a big, huge loss leader for electric and gas. And it, ironically, Jack Gilhooly was the president of TNJ. He had formerly been a commissioner of the New York City Transit Authority, a lawyer. He's a good guy, but he was very easily stressed out. And I remember when we had some severe differences, he would turn beet red, and I would worry about us having a heart attack or a stroke. But he sort of inadvertently triggered the acceleration of the whole takeover of TNJ. He was fighting it, but he produced a supplement to the Star Ledger that went out with a Christmas edition or something. It was excoriating the state government for not giving enough subsidy to TNJ. And I was furious that he would be spending state money to publicly lambaste the subsidy program. So I accelerated everything several months ahead of schedule and said, look, we can't let this continue. You're going to have to work harder and faster to wrap up some of the draft legislation and the studies and so forth. So I would never intended or expected that we could get legislation within a year of my arrival, but we did.
Apart from Jack Gilhooly, were there other people at public service who were arguing for retaining the operations?
Not really.
That
there was they would have been happy to part with it, except that they were putting a price tag on it that was, we thought, impossible. But Jack had a personal stake. He was president and enjoyed the perks of office.
And he apparently was given quite a bit of leash by his bosses at public service
to
go his own way.
Yeah, and he's a very aggressive guy and a decent guy. You know, I don't hold it against him, but if I were in his shoes, I'm sure I'd want to do the same sort of thing.
Okay. Now, at what point do you think he sort of got reined in, or if he ever was, and told by his bosses at public service
he was clearly
they wanted to sell?
Yeah, he was clearly reined in. And as it turned out, thanks again to Alan Lowenstein, who was an outside attorney, who proffered his services at a very low rate, though much lower than anything he normally got, but he felt this was an important public service, so he helped us negotiate a deal that found ways to save a lot of money for PSE&G in treatment of pensions and tax credits, so it reduced the price, and then we got a federal grant that permitted us to acquire it at $0 from state sources. Again, some of the opponents were incredulous because they predicted we'd be paying through the nose to acquire TNJ.
To your knowledge, given Governor Burns' sort of prior role at the Public Utilities Commission and his sort of interest, did he get involved personally in negotiating or going above Gilhooly to the Public Service Board?
To my knowledge, not that I know of, I don't think so. I think it was pretty much played out pretty directly and openly.
But was there any backdoor strategy to try to influence the public service executives to sort of more moderate in terms
of
the negotiations?
I'm not aware of it. I didn't engage in it. I knew the chairman of PSE&G at the time, Bob. There were four or five Bobs, Bob Van Fossen. I forgot his name. Bob
Smith?
Could have been simple, Smith. Like Smith or... and I think we had conversations, but not serious negotiations, and I didn't try twisting his arm or try to read his motivations. I think it was pretty clear they would like to have unloaded, but they also had a price that we were unprepared to meet, and so it took time to work out an acceptable deal.
Was there any key point in those negotiations where you said things are going to go our way?
The burden of the pension, well, the hardcore nuts were the burden of the pension and the value attributed to the assets, and we kept whittling away at those. No, I don't remember, but Alan Lowenstein played a very key role, and just were, I think the state is in his debt for the role he played in doing that. Mm-hmm. But that opened up, it's like the Holland Tunnel and the Port Authority early days. That became the central core, to which was added all the smaller companies, and you then had a critical mass. And this was before the federal government unloaded all the commuter railroads, mm-hmm. which came a couple of years later. So there's time to get legs on the institution and some positive momentum before you had to take on the railroads as well.
Well, why don't we move on to the railroads now and discuss that process?
Well, that acquisition occurred after I left office and was, I think, extremely well done, again, by Primo and Martin Robbins and the like. That was a consequence of the federal actions to reorganize all the bankrupt railroads, separating passenger service from freight. They created Conrail to acquire all the freight interests of the bankrupts and then offloaded, dumped the passenger services on each of the metropolitan areas, and including some burdens that totally unjustified. For example, the pension load that was assigned to the offloaded passenger service was way out of proportion to the number of people acquired with the passenger service. So we were paying for 50 years of service by people working only in freight over the last 50 years, gross inequity imposed by the feds on the states. And that was really done, again, by legislative fiat at the federal level. But it was well managed, I think, by not only this state, but other states. And having been dealt a lousy hand, they did a good job, I think, of managing the acquisition and transition. Hmm.
Stepping back and sort of looking at it more broadly, I'd be interested in your sort of comments about the role of the railroads, particularly in New Jersey, because they've had a long and sometimes scandalous history in terms of their influence in government and politics in this state.
I remember meeting Stuart Saunders, a legendary chairman of Pennsylvania Railroad, and being awed by him. And then he managed the merger with the New York Central Railroad. So this behemoth of New York Central Pennsylvania Railroad was created, I guess, in 1970, I think. And all of it folded in 2-3 years. The railroads have been a peculiar, difficult part of transportation. You look back in the history of the robber barons of the turn of the last century. My experience with the railroads and the port authorities has always been they've been very, very difficult, arrogant, overbearing. They certainly were reluctant operators of passenger service when passenger service became unprofitable, and understandably so. But in many ways, they did it with such almost contempt, or at least lacking in grace and understanding of the politics. So it alienated the passengers, it alienated the communities. They were bridling at the cross subsidies. And I think it just made, it might have accelerated the whole collapse of the railroads and resulted in this, which in effect gave new life to the freight part of the railroad business. But it's had a culture that was always taking advantage of its power and really unduly bearing on other institutions without regard to any effort at finding common ground or cooperation.
Why don't we stop now and take a break?
Sure.
Lou, after the creation of New Jersey Transit, let's talk a little bit more about sort of the negotiations with the labor unions at the time and how difficult or how sort of accommodating were they in sort of dealing with this new entity.
Well, we fully expected that that could be a problem, particularly in the drafting of the NJ Transit bill, especially labor protective provisions as well as the continuity of agreements and the like. And we entered into pretty substantial and continuing negotiations. The two biggest unions were both industrial unions, the Amalgamated Transit Union and the Transport Workers Union. Those were the first we had to deal with because they represented all the employees of the bus companies. Later, in the offloading of passenger services, then came all the craft unions of the AFL, the Brotherhood of Railroad Employees. It's interesting to note that the two lead union negotiators at the time, who were then vice presidents of their respective unions, went on to become president of both unions, and highly respected. And I must say our relations with them were excellent. I mean, they negotiated tough, but we came to very easy agreement on how to compromise some of the issues, and it's been a good relationship ever since. Along those lines, mentioning NJ Transit as the spawning ground for leaders, a lot of operating people have gone on to other systems around the country to become general managers elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. During your time as commissioner, you also made some attempts to get a more permanent sort of financing mechanism for transportation, yeah, and particularly for transit. Talk a little bit about that.
That was the single largest undone job that when I left office. I guess I had been lobbying 6 months or so for a nickel gas tax increase. And I packed on, covered all of my slides and charts. It was a compelling case. This is now 27 years later. And in the intervening 27 years, we've gone up 2 cents on a base of 10.5 cents that puts us third lowest in the country. As we were talking earlier about fare increases and the like, this is lost opportunity. We're down at 10 cents. Most of the pack is up around 25 and 30 cents. That represents billions and billions of lost opportunity to upgrade our transit and our highways. Tom Kaine, when he became governor, tried to pick up and push the same agenda, couldn't get it through. He persevered and got the Transportation Trust Fund through, which was great. And for years, that was the safety valve. And even that now is bankrupt. The state is facing a very severe crisis. The public is not the least bit aware of the nature of the crisis. Lacking adequate capacity for now, much less later. Deteriorating physical conditions. No funding to make critical improvements in safety and other aspects of transportation, and the nation is facing a similar dilemma. Despite this grand transportation bill that was recently authorized, the funding is not there to get it through the 6 years that it's supposedly authorized for. So we have been, probably in my lifetime, more failing to meet the transportation needs and the infrastructure needs than any point in my life. We did far better during the Depression and even the war years in protecting our infrastructure than we are now. Mm-hmm. So this is a crisis that continues, and it's outrageous that the most densely populated state with the most heavily trafficked highways, with the most affluent per capita income, still has the third lowest gas tax in the country.
Mm-hmm. We've discussed primarily your sort of role in the development of public transit in New Jersey. Let's spend some time dealing with the sort of highway and other infrastructure that you sort of assume as Commissioner of Transportation. Was this sort of difficult, given your sort of bent for public transit,
no,
to sort of know that you're responsible also for building new highways?
No, I didn't. It didn't trouble me at all, and I think I won the respect of the highway interests that I wasn't blindly anti-highway. I weighed in on a couple of things, one of which particularly didn't ingratiate me with the highway interest, but for the most part, my conclusion was the interstate system was committed, was almost done, and if anything, I worked to accelerate the completion of I-287, I-78, because there were missing links by the time I became commissioner. I did take the leadership or lead to de-designate I-95 through Hopewell and Pennington because our studies showed that with their completion, the surrounding highways would be even worse off than they would be without its completion, and that we could redesignate the turnpike as I-95 and for continuity. And I don't regret that. Part of my motivation was to capture the funding because we needed the funding for transit. But most of the highway program proceeded, if anything, on an accelerated basis during my tenure. And I'm a realist enough to know that that is the main, or has been, the main system of public or passenger transport since World War II. On the other hand, I think, as I've argued since my time as commissioner, the clock is running out. We can't build more highways to deal with population growth or expansion of commerce. We have to increase our dependency on public transportation.
You say you don't regret the I-95 de-designation decision, even with the passage of time and the congestion on Route 1 and other roads?
Well, the Route 1 congestion is not rooted in the failure to do I-95. It's rooted in the total failure of communities or state role in through carrots and sticks in getting the communities to cooperate on logical planning. I mean, as saturated as that highway is, we continue to build new shopping centers and particularly campus-type office buildings and developments that are totally dependent on the automobile and no capacity to tap into public transit access or to weigh my last major, the other thing besides the gas tax that I didn't get through, my efforts toward the end of my tenure to get the mayors of that strip to come together and jointly agree, as we did on developing the state plan, that we all hang together or we hang separately. And this is an opportunity to try to rationalize development that will benefit all rather than work at cross purposes. And it's a totally anarchic process of get every rateable you can and the hell with what happens on the traffic in the next township.
And I guess from your comments, you're suggesting that one other undone item on the state's agenda is a stronger land use sort of planning and regulatory role.
Yeah, I must say I get discouraged about that. When I left public service to go to the Blaustein School, I started an effort on smart growth, and it's like bailing out the ocean with a bucket or a thimble. The forces at work are so overwhelming to do their own thing and get in with the maximum profit, the maximum rateable, and not worry about the consequences to others.
Mm-hmm. Now, as Governor Byrne sort of nears the end of his second term in office, what were your sort of personal considerations and sort of what you did next in terms of your career?
Well, I had a contract to return to the Port Authority. I had invested 22 years and expected to retire from the Port Authority. So just a few months before the end of Byrne's term, an opening developed at the Port Authority at a senior level. A person retired, and it seemed like a natural for me to go back and fill that role. So I was invited to do so, and it was near the end of the term, so it seemed like a likely evolution.
Now that you've had this sort of period as commissioner of the State Department of Transportation, did your sort of views toward the value and role of authorities in general change? You obviously, as commissioner, probably had some conflicts with authorities like the Turnpike Authority and at the time the Highway Authority and other sort of semi-autonomous authorities in terms of integrating transportation policy. Did your perspective change at all?
It changed. I don't think it really changed. What it did was sober my thinking about how authorities can get off course. I mentioned to some degree I thought the Port Authority was politically insensitive. As far as I'm concerned, the Turnpike was impossible to work with. And that's a function of the decisions made on the selection of the top staff member or the chairman of the authority or who comprises the authority. I felt then, and I was delighted to see, I think it was Tom Kane, who made the commissioner ex officio a member of those boards. That's as it should be. In fact, even go further, it should be the chairman of those boards, as is the New Jersey Transit experience. When I was commissioner, the Turnpike was grossly uncooperative on most things, and it continued after I left. When I was back at the Port Authority, I set something up called Transcom, a cooperative of 16 highway authorities in New York and New Jersey to coordinate rush hour traffic and how to work out of major disruptions on a cooperative basis and share information, share emergency equipment. The one holdout of 16 organizations in both states was the Turnpike. They didn't want to cooperate. They wanted nobody interfering with their turf. And it took my appeal to Governor Kane's office to get them to back down and join the group. Mm-hmm. Now, things have improved since then, but it's an example. Somebody told me, it was LaPola, told me that Byrne remembers when he was pressing the Turnpike Authority to build 13A exit and was said, told flatly, no way, you know, we're not going to do it. Mm-hmm. And they got away with it.
Now, I assume they got away with it because they had sort of politically powerful people
exactly.
on their board.
Yeah. Byrne gave them wide berth, and it appalled me because they were so arrogantly uncooperative.
Did you ever talk to him about
yeah.
that or try to lobby?
Yeah, matter of fact, when I stayed, he was planning to get me appointed to the board, but since then it's now across the board that the commissioner is a member of the boards.
Okay. But were there people that you suggested for appointments other than yourself at ex officio? Who he rejected?
No, because I don't remember any vacancies occurring during my tenure. It was a lock on the mm-hmm. part of the chairman.
But of course, this is in his second term when
yeah.
presumably he had enough time to put his own appointees on the
yeah,
board.
Yeah, but he was excessively deferential, and I never quite understood it. I don't know what kind of political clout these guys had. But.
Okay, well, now, any other sort of unfinished business as you sort of start packing up and decide to go back to the Port Authority toward the end
no,
of this term?
My biggest disappointment was the nickel gas tax. I just thought that was so vital. And I computed, when I was on the Blue Ribbon Commission for McGreevy, and I did a rough calculation that it was $5 to $10 billion in lost opportunity, just the nickel. And that would have still kept us at the bottom of the heap compared to all other states.
Okay. Well, let's proceed with the sort of career chronology as you go back to the Port Authority and take it from there.
Well, I went back to this job called the Director of Administration, overseeing all the staff departments, personnel, and procurement, and the like, and did that for 5 years. Found it interesting, but not as challenging as running something. Then I was given the job of Trans-Hudson, Assistant Executive Director for Trans-Hudson Transportation, wherein I oversaw PATH, the tunnels, bridges, terminals, and that's in that capacity created this Transcom regional operation. I created something else called Transit Center, a consortium of transit operators, MTA, NJ Transit, to cooperate on shared signing, fares, and stuff like that. And then, at a point, decided it was time to move on. I had 32 years of credited service, and retired and took a position as president of the Institute of Public Administration. Was in that job only 7 weeks when I got a full court press to go to Philadelphia. I tried to refuse several times, but the chairman of the board was a superb human being. Rock of integrity, and he persevered and finally broke me down, and I felt embarrassed that it was too soon to leave a job that I had just started. But the board of the Institute was very understanding and felt that this was an important mission.
Who was that SEPTA chairman?
Clayton Underkoffler. He's in his mid-60s and has bad health, and breaks my heart because one of the handful of people that I regarded as outstanding people in my lifetime.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to backtrack a little and go back to your last months as commissioner in Trenton. Governor Byrne was lobbying, or was being lobbied at that time, to approve a fare increase for pass. You, of course, I think, had recused yourself as commissioner, given right. your continuing sort of relationship with the Port Authority. But your one of your predecessors as commissioner, Alan Sagner, was now chairman of the yep. Port Authority Board. So even though you weren't directly involved, were you sort of rooting on one side or the other, if not visibly?
Well, I had a discussion with Byrne over the years that it's the one thing that I think I ever flatly disagreed with him on, that I was no fan of increased cost of charges for public transportation. I really think they should be as low as they possibly can be, but in the context of short funding and such great needs, A, and B, in fairness to all of the user fees that are applied, I thought that the fares should be allowed to go up. They couldn't even go up equal to inflation, because to most transit systems in the country are subsidized anywhere from 66% to 35%. That means the majority of the budget is subsidy from other government entities. So to keep up with inflation, you have to double the rate of inflation to just keep even. Nobody recommends that, because it's too much of a hit for most poor young people, old people. But there should be some capacity to move, at least as a pass against inflation, and to augment other sources of funding in order to do all the things you have to do. And we are in a major crisis that is not appreciated or known right now, in failure to keep the maintenance up, to improve the safety and other kinds of operational things needed, but most of all, to build great new capacity. And through my lifetime, even during the Depression, we built new tunnels and bridges and highways, and we not only did it help the economy and jobs, but it built the capacity for the future generations to fill. We don't have that luxury anymore. We're beyond the capacity design for many of our institutions, and it's getting worse daily.
Mm-hmm. And before we move on from the sort of Byrne administration, I'd be interested in your comments about sort of the sort of day-to-day working relationship with Governor Byrne, with the staff. You had almost a unique role. You were in the cabinet, but you were still essentially an employee of the Port Authority on leave. So you had a much different sort of, I guess, relationship in terms of accountability to Governor Byrne. You could always go back to the Port Authority if things didn't go your way, or you thought the commitment you had received when you were offered the job were broken. But sort of talk about, when would you sort of deal directly with the governor? When would you deal with staff? Did you think cabinet meetings were productive, or just how was that relationship in those years?
Well, you know, the irony is that there was a lot of publicity attending my nomination. A couple of newspapers opposed my taking the job with any connection with the Port Authority, that it would be a conflict of interest. But in the course of the publicity, it highlighted the fact that I'd never registered in either party, attended a political function, could donate it to a political candidate. So it underscored my professional, nonpartisan commitment through my career, which was a plus, because later, when getting legislation through was ticklish, and it could easily have gone under because I would be viewed as politically ambitious or committed to the Democratic Party. That was not a problem, as it was for some of my predecessors. So the publicity had mixed results. It led to some editorials that reluctantly concluded that there should be no tie and therefore it would be conflict. And I committed to, originally the Port Authority was going to supplement my salary, make me whole. That was considered unconstitutional. So that the deal was I would go back, and over time my position would be recovered over the time that I returned. I recused myself directly from Port Authority decisions. I delegated my deputy, who I appointed, who had been Commissioner of Transportation in Minnesota, and I asked him to handle all Port Authority matters without my involvement. But at the time, there really weren't that many issues. A lot of the things had already happened, like the decision to for the Port Authority to give the state $120 million to support this transpac. So there wasn't too much of substance that really came up. My access to the governor, I rarely asked for time with the governor. I usually worked through his chief of staff, Bob Mulcahy, who was superb in that role, in my opinion. However, in the first month, we had nearly a showdown because the governor got ticked at me twice when he thought I was being unduly supportive of Republicans. One of them was the unveiling of a new locomotive in Red Bank, New Jersey, when the only local legislator to appear was the Republican state senator. And this appeared on the front page of the New York Times, and it really upset the governor that the Republican was getting the play when, in fact, we invited all the local elected officials. So I said to Bob Mulcahy, will you tell the governor that I've been in office a month, we had this deal about my not being involved politically, I think I'm getting a bum rap on this, and I'm prepared to come up with an acceptable public alibi on why I'm going back to the Port Authority, but I'd just as soon get back there if I'm going to be challenged on incidents of this sort. After that, we never had a problem. I was never really accused of playing political favorites or anything like that. The fact that I had the contract was an important thing for me to have the comfort to say that to him.
What were cabinet meetings like?
I thought they were very productive. Certainly Byrne encouraged free-flowing exchange of ideas, I thought. And some of them had good presentations from outsiders. I remember the annual report on the economic state of the state. That was very useful. I had a lot of respect for colleagues in the cabinet, and I thought they were both great socially, but also substantively.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's go back again and sort of talk a little bit about the SEPTA years, not in much detail, but more, I guess, in contrast to your other positions with the Port Authority and with the New Jersey state government.
Well, the SEPTA experience, but for the chairman, who was formerly a U.S. attorney, he was a Republican appointed by a Democratic governor to straighten out what was a severely chaotic condition. And I thoroughly enjoyed working with him.
In way of background, perhaps you should give an overview of what SEPTA's responsibilities
are. Well, SEPTA is the regional but single state transit operator in Philadelphia. It reaches into the suburbs and even comes as far as Trenton, New Jersey, but it's a single state creature authorized by the state of Pennsylvania. The name SEPTA stands for Southeastern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority. It embraces five southeastern counties, four suburban counties, and the city and county of Philadelphia. It's a great, extensive network of rail, light rail, that is trolleys, heavy rail, commuter rail, subway, commuter rail, and bus system. Has perennially been underfunded and perennially been badly intruded in the worst of political intrusions, patronage and favoritism and contracts and that sort of thing. So our job was to, bring professionalism and integrity, and the chairman was a rock of integrity, and I think we've made a lot of progress. Then the chairman, his term ended and he left, and the jungle started to creep back, and that's when I decided I'd had enough after 2 years of that. What I mean is undue pressure on hiring people because of their political connections or their contract connections. Mm-hmm. And that to me, 50 years of public service, and I've been able to not get drawn into that, playing that game, Port Authority, New Jersey, or SEPTA. And I'm relieved and proud of it, but it's a messy kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Once you start down that road, there's no way to hold the battlements that that the jungle just moves in. Mm.
And then in accepting the SEPTA position, you couldn't really propose the type of guarantee you did with from Governor Byrne in terms of political...
With the chairman.
With the chairman, but that ended when he left.
Exactly. But he had total support from the governor, and he had the public esteem so that nobody was going to fool around with him. So that was a, you know, it's a golden period, much like Port Authority and the Byrne years.
Okay. And what other sort of contrasts with SEPTA and your other roles did could you describe?
A lot more political, public visibility. I was, of course, in Jersey, I had a lot of ink as well, but mostly in the print press. In SEPTA, I was on television all the time, either pushing a political agenda for funding for the SEPTA or whatever, but I was on a lot of interview programs. So I had a lot more visibility, more political involvement on a continuing basis. I led a statewide funding effort involving all the other transit operators, Pittsburgh and some 30 small cities, and we got a basic dedicated tax through in 1991, which was bought us some time. It wasn't enough to really structurally fix the problem, but it got us through 10 years or so.
Okay. And I assume that part of SEPTA's problems is also the tension between Philadelphia as the center city and the sort of suburban.
Well, yeah, and that to me was dramatically, it made me furious. The instrument through which federal funds flow, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, is a bi-state organization called the DVRPC. And the decisions on how to allocate transportation money, transit, highway, and the like, are largely in that unit. Out of 18 voting members, I was a non-voting member. I could attend the meetings and sound off, but I couldn't vote, but as a transit general manager. But out of 18 members, only one from the city and county that had half the population. These little podunk communities in the suburbs each had one. The county and lead city of all eight suburban counties had two votes, but the city and county of Philadelphia had one. It's a monstrous and, I think, extreme example of the complete unfairness. One man, one vote is a joke when it comes to critical decisions on priorities, on whether the money goes into a new highway to support a shopping center in the suburbs or to fix a crumbling station serving thousands of inner-city poor residents. And it just drove me crazy. The city representative was much, much more conciliatory than I would have been or was. But I sounded off, and I made some inroads, but at a political price.
Mm-hmm. And, Lou, since you left SEPTA, you've continued to be active in national groups and as an advisor and consultant to both, state and regional and national bodies. And most recently, you've served as a member of the Transition Task Force for Governor Corzine on the Department of Transportation and Transportation Policy. Do you want to sort of give an update as to what you sort of see the challenges now? I mean, you've touched on a few of them in terms of financing and the like, but what do you think currently are the major priorities?
Well, I feel strongly that that's the number one priority, that we're in a deep, deep hole. It can't be solved overnight, but there needs to be a big Band-Aid to get us by the next year or two, and a structure to manage us through the next 10, 20 years to fix the second and third round of this. I think we are less well-equipped than at any time in my lifetime to deal with the current and future problems. The Port Authority used to be a major player. Its financing capacity has been dissipated by political deals to put money into projects of very limited importance, and therefore lost the capacity to accumulate big enough bucks to do the major projects like the new tunnel across the Hudson River to serve public transportation and other major projects. Historically, even in the worst of economic times, in the Depression, we built the George Washington Bridge, the Lincoln Tunnel, the Holland Tunnel just before the Depression. And all through the years, another round of it in the 50s, jointly with the Tribord Bridge and Tunnel, led to the second deck of the George, the third tube of the Lincoln, the construction of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, the Throgs Neck Bridge. We're not doing any of that. So we're not preparing for the next generation. What we're doing, almost criminally, is borrowing all of the capacity of our future revenues through long-term bonding indebtedness. So we're consuming that revenue stream now. In fact, this is advocated as a panacea. Indiana has just gotten a bid of $3 billion to give 75 years of toll revenue on their toll road to private interests, I think, from Australia. That's pernicious. It's like excessive bonding where you're paying interest, as we are in the Transportation Trust Fund, for 25 and 30 years and not having any capacity to make any improvements currently or for the next 20, 30 years. So that's ill-advised, short-term view, and we're digging ourselves deeper and deeper in that hole. So that is an essential ingredient: institutional capacity, reviving the capacity of the Port Authority to do the kind of regional mega projects. One part of the dissipation was acceding to political pressures to siphon off money. The other is the failure to move rates and fares sufficient to keep up with the requirements. But the short of it is there's not the leadership in the Port Authority. It has been diminished in its capacity to take leadership, plan the projects, and implement them. The other part of the dissipation is to put a lot of its capacity into projects that we're not needed. The Port Authority or the region doesn't need. Now, a comment was made earlier about their involvement in trash to energy. They got into projects on their merit, made sense, but dissipated the funding. Teleport, a new manufacturing firm to create local jobs. Well, that's not the highest and best use of the funding capacity, the leadership, or the long-term planning and track record of execution of mega projects of the dimension of the bridges, tunnels, airports, and that sort of thing.
Apart from the Port Authority's sort of fiscal capacity, there's been some recent discussion about trying to increase the financial contribution of, for example, the New Jersey Turnpike Authority, and also somewhat related discussion about privatization or leasing of major highways. Yep. And what's your position on those
ideas? Well, privatization and the long-term leasing of assets, to me, are of a kind. They are really ways of the public decision makers of avoiding necessary responsibility for building, protecting, and improving assets for the current users and the future users. Having said that, there are ideologues who say it's the answer to everything. Well, that's bull, and it's been proven to be bull in both cases. But it has utility. I mean, there are some limited cases where it makes sense. At the very least, it's important to sober up not only the unions but the civil servants that it ain't a free ride for public service or unions, that for new projects, sometimes you may have to think radically, but it is not a panacea. And I think it's unfortunate because it becomes mesmerizing. I attended a meeting a week ago in Washington, and a senator or congressman, former state senator from Florida, describes this process as being the answer to all of our prayers. Well, it's nonsense. Absolute nonsense. I think these things have to be confronted. I don't think they should be star chamber or lame duck sessions. They ought to be front and center for the public to understand. You are the beneficiaries, quality of life, jobs, all of these things are at risk. Either you're prepared to be in tune with the rest of the world and be at the average or above in gas tax, or you deserve exactly what you're getting in congestion, lack of capacity, and conditions that are anything but good.
Lou, before we end, I want to go back again to another memory of the Byrne administration. I recall sitting in a, I believe it was a cabinet meeting, it might have been just a budget meeting, with Commissioner Ann Klein, who was then head of the Department of Human Services. And she made the point that the per capita subsidy for rail and bus commuters, at least at that time, was higher than the monthly welfare payment that the state was providing. And she argued that that showed...
Well, sort of the fare or the subsidy?
The subsidy.
That's good, isn't it?
Well, that's my question. She was arguing that as a matter of public policy, that the poor people who were on welfare really should be getting higher priority than the somewhat middle to upper class suburban commuters who are having their fares subsidized by the state of New Jersey. And nowadays, we have that same debate on the national level in terms of very limited resources, in terms of how much more we spend on transit given the other priorities. And I wanted at least to give you the platform to make the case for why, as a matter of policy, transit should have priorities.
Well, first of all, I think the charges that transit subsidies are somehow evil or bad is fraudulent. The American way of dealing with transportation is to assume the auto is king and not report the full cost of the automobile. So there are several hundred million dollars, billion dollars a year that are subsidizing automobiles. This is over and above the gas tax revenue. This is out of county, local government budgets, out of other federal programs. Secondly, I would argue vehemently that it is in the public interest to have as many people ride public transit as can or will, because it reduces the pressure on the highways for congestion or the high cost of continuing to build more highways that spawn pollution, problems of parking in the cities and the like. It's environmentally necessary. It's vital to people who don't have automobiles, the poor, the young, the old, the disabled, for the most part, are unable to access automobiles. The very young before driver's license, or the old who are past driving age and so forth. Finally, our dependency on foreign oil. At last, 50 years, 40 years since the first oil shock, two oil shocks, two Gulf Wars, the escalating price of gasoline. Finally, we're talking about alternative sources of energy to reduce dependency on Near Eastern oil. We're 50 years late with that as a national priority. And a key aspect of it is not only new sources of energy, but increasing reliance on public transportation. It is absolutely monstrous to talk about disassembling Amtrak. On 9/11, the airlines were grounded. The vehicular access to Manhattan was stopped because of the priority of emergency vehicles. The only lifeline was Amtrak, NJ Transit, and city subways, the public transit systems. If the crisis, if we were in threat of other major explosions and we had panic, it could have been a disaster. If people felt trapped and couldn't get home and for days at a time, it could have been an absolute worse calamity than it actually was. So for my 50 years, I've been enraged by this tendency of some academics who have undue status in Washington to keep carping about the subsidies of public transit and ignore. When I was at SEPTA, I was going nuts with our crisis of limited funding and the ease with which we were committing to $300 to $500 billion of savings and loan bailout, or the price of an aircraft carrier running a couple of $1 billion, which was the total for several years of the whole country subsidy to transit.
I think that's probably a good place to stop, unless there are any final comments you wanted to make.
No, I think you covered a lot of ground.
Thank you.